Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So, as he said, my name is Vijay. This is largely joint work with Leo. So I understand there's a Leo here as well. I don't know who Leo is. You're Leo, hi. But when I say Leo in this talk, Leo ranges over Leopold Haller, okay? So it's a universe of size one. So hopefully there will be no ambiguity about that. Okay, so I started my PhD in around 2008, and in early 2009, I interned in Microsoft Research in India. And when I came back to Oxford, there was a guy sitting in my office, and I said, who are you? And he said, I'm a PhD student of Daniel Kerning. And he said, who are you? And I said, I'm a PhD student of Daniel Kerning. And I said, well, if you are, then where have you been all this time? And he said, I was interning in Microsoft Research. And he said, where have you been all this time? And I said, I was interning in Microsoft Research. And so I was working in India with Sriram Rajamani and Aditya Nuri, and we were working on applying abstract interpretation to study some of their tools. And Leo was working Microsoft Research Cambridge on implementing SAT solvers using FPGAs, okay? So this talk is what happens when you put two Microsoft Research interns in one room, okay? So so the beginning of the talk is kind of like in terms of a large body of work, which is where my work starts, actually the happy ending. This is from CAV 2009. Some people are receiving an award, and they're receiving an award for doing a lot of work on SAT solvers. And what they achieved can be summarized in this graph that we have redrawn from Communications of the ACM article from 2009. So Boolean satisfiability is the classic NP-complete problem. But what has happened in the last 12 years is that the performance of SAT solvers has improved approximately exponentially every year. Okay, and you can observe this if you do benchmarks today on solvers from previous years. So it's not because of Moore's law. The implementations and the algorithms that are being used in the solvers have been improving over time. Okay, and so there is a nice survey about this. And the survey concludes with a question that a lot of people are asking and have been thinking about and working on, in fact, which is, okay, so there is a really hard problem, and there are some algorithms and solvers, really practical solvers, to solve this hard problem. And it's not clear how well we understand why this happens, but the other question is, given that we have this performance improvement, can we replicate it on other problems, right? There are lots of other problems that we want to solve, and can we take the lessons of SAT solvers and apply them to new problem domains? And there are many ways in which you can try to do this. And the way we have chosen is to use the theory of abstract interpretation to take the lessons of SAT solvers to new domains. Okay? And specifically, when we started the work, we weren't thinking about SAT solvers or even abstract interpretation broadly construed. We were looking at a very specific problem of bounding the values of variables in floating point programs. And these programs that we were given had loops with constant bounded number of iterations, okay? So it's really not the hardest case of the program verification problem. And in fact, it's a subcase of the problem that can be solved by bounded model checkers as well, because the loops are bounded by a constant number of iterations. So at that time, we wrote, so Daniel had implemented a bounded model checker called CBMC, and then Leo wrote an abstract interpreter. And what we found was that we could get very fast results using the simple interval abstraction that we implemented, but often we lost precision, okay? Whereas with the bounded model checker, because of the bound on the number of loops, we would just unwind to the number of loop iterations required, and we could often prove things, but then things might time out, okay? And using the work that I will talk about today, what we can do, or the performance that we get today, looks something like this, the blue line. So you see that it behaves, so it's not really the bounded model checker, but like the SAT algorithm that's inside the bounded model checker. And literally at a high level, what we've done here is embed the interval abstract domain inside a SAT solver, right? So it's like a SAT solver which knows about intervals, which knows about arithmetic. So, but the algorithm, the structure of the algorithm is the SAT algorithm, and you can see that the problems that are hard for the bounded model checking are hard for our case. But it's a lot faster because it knows about intervals and arithmetic, so it's able to use a certain abstraction natively. Since we did this work, which was published in Takas, Leo has collaborated with Alberto Griccio on developing a solver for floating point arithmetic. This work is unpublished. These are very recent results. And Leo will be here in about a week or two. So if you have a lot more questions about this, I suggest you can ask him, because so there's a lot of work that we did, and I will talk more at a high level about the algorithms and the scheme for developing more algorithms, and he will be able to tell you a lot of very specific things when he comes here shortly. Okay, so what they observed was that on bit vector encodings of floating point satisfiability problems, they are able to perform much better than C3. So bit vector encodings of yes, okay. So yeah, I should be a bit more precise.
And how will it then? There are two different colors.
What's that? Sat and unsat. Yes. Okay, so again, this is kind of the point where I will say a little more at the lower level, and after this I will go into how did we develop this algorithm and what can I prove about it. Okay, so to give you some high-level intuition, suppose you had a program like this. The details are not too important. What you need to know is that there is a lot of branching behavior and there are a lot of case distinctions that you have to make here. And if you were going to do this explicitly, like enumerating cases or so, then there would be some amount of explosion. And what the tool does is it reasons with intervals, and the structure of the search that the tool uses looks something like this. So it tries to solve the problem using naive interval propagation, and if that succeeds, that's good. If that doesn't succeed, you start splitting on intervals, so you take a narrower interval. But if you were to just split on intervals, then you would have an exponential growth in the search space. And this is the difference. Clause learning SAT solvers don't always have that exponential growth because they do clause learning. So you can go down some path and say, given that the variable is in the interval 12, 16, I can prove that it's correct. You can learn something from this, so you don't actually have to prove the intervals, you know, minus infinity to 11 and 16 to infinity. Okay. So the learning allows you to generalize from what you have proved. It's kind of what's going on. So this is kind of really the high-level summary, and I will, in the rest of the talk, really talk about the, really give you more details on the algorithm that is doing this, okay? But first, I want to step back a bit and just give a kind of overview of some ideas or some things about logic, because I think they're kind of relevant. So mathematical logic as we know it started with the work of George Boole, and this is relevant because at the time, algebra was being developed very actively in Britain with the work of Cayley and Hamilton and the British algebraists and group theorists. And so logic, as George Boole conceived it, was algebraic, meaning he said, how do I formalize the Aristotelian notion of syllogisms? Well, he had some set of propositions, and he had operations on these propositions, which formed some algebra. Okay. The work he did didn't give us Boolean algebras as we know them today. That was done by De Morgan and Schroeder, who sorted out. So Boole didn't have the distributive law in the form that we know it today. And basically, by the work of these people, we had Boolean algebras as we know them today. So at the end of the 19th century, logic was algebraic. Logic was done on algebraic structures. And that changed with the work of Frege, because Frege was the first person to really go significantly beyond what was known in Aristotelian logic by formalizing quantification. So existential universal quantification over variables and some form of second order quantification. Okay, and this was the path where logic started diverging from the algebraic tradition, because even today, if you try to formalize quantification over an algebra, that's not very easy. Okay, and his work was used, well, his work was not very well known at the time, but it was read by the young Bertrand Russell, who wrote to him and said, you know, there is a problem here, and he discovered Russell's paradox. And Frege, in fact, included an acknowledgement as his work was going to the printer saying, you know, the young man has discovered this flaw in my life's work, and he put it in the second volume. And lots of people have commented on his integrity as a scientist because of his ability to do that. So shaken by this discovery, Bertrand Russell collaborated with Alfred North Whitehead, and they wrote the Principia Mathematica to try and formalize mathematics and the notion of proof. And you would ask, well, who in their right mind would read something that takes 260 pages to reach something, to set up the mathematics required to prove that 1 plus 1 is 2, well, that man actually did it and proved his famous incompleteness theorems. And the reason all of this is relevant is because from this point on, with quantification, you started working with sets and relations, okay? And so logic, as it's taught in undergraduate classes today, and as most people do it, is largely over sets and relations, and not algebra. But I'm going to argue that modern SAT solvers are working with a kind of algebraic semantics, and abstract interpretation also takes off from the algebraic semantics, so there is a good motivation for us to look at that. Okay, so the one additional relevant point is the work of Charles Sanders Peirce, who formalized a lot of ideas, and some people have called him one of the greatest American philosophers of the 19th century. And he articulated the distinction between different types of reasoning. So specifically, these words will be used later in the talk. Assume you have something like a formula phi, and then you derive from it psi. So the process of starting with phi and deriving psi, I will call deduction. Okay. Now, sometimes you have background knowledge. This background knowledge is a theory, like the theory of the natural numbers or Presburger arithmetic, so on. So if you have a background theory, then you do deduction in a theory. Okay, if you are instead given the formula phi and you're asked to derive a psi that implies phi, this is abduction. Okay, so you are already given the conclusion and you want to know what is the starting point. And similarly, you can do abduction in a theory. So you're given the theory and you're given the goal. You need to find out what is the starting point to start from here and go there. Okay, all right. So we can get a bit more concrete. What is all this algebra stuff that I'm talking about? Give you some very basic definitions and jargon that I need. So we have two truth values, true and false. I will use variables ranging over a set of set var. A literal is a variable or its negation. A clause is a disjunction of literals. Conjunctive normal form is a conjunction of clauses. An assignment is a map from variables to truth values. Okay. So what is an example of a lattice? A standard lattice, I can give you two sets, P and Q. You can close them under union or intersection. The least element would be the empty set. The top element would contain all elements of the set. Okay, so this is something that would be called the power set lattice. Now, how does logic correspond to lattices? There is a very standard algebra called the Lindenbaum-Tarski algebra. You can take formulae and order them by implication, and you quotient them so that equivalent formulae form the same element. So for example, false is the bottom element, true is the top element, so P and Q is here, P and Q will imply P, will imply Q, and so on, right? You have a lattice like this. So these two would be the same. Now suppose you have a program, and the program has two variables, P and Q, and they have data type bool, right? Then the set of environments that your program can have would also form a lattice, which looks exactly like what we saw earlier, which in their paper they called the collecting semantics of the program, right? Or not. The state space of the program, I guess. Collecting semantics requires more. Yes, so it's not entirely correct. It's part of the collecting semantics, I guess. That's okay. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is we can have sets, we can have logical formulae, and then we can think in terms of programs about the same object. Okay, and I will draw this analogy continuously through the talk. And this correspondence you can prove if you want, but it's not relevant at this point. Okay, so essentially, you can think of a formula or the model of a formula as an element in a lattice. The implication order becomes the order on the lattice, subset order in this case, but it won't be in general. And composition of formulae can be thought of as operations on the lattice. Okay. And what is the satisfiability problem? So now you have assignments which go from variables to values, and a model, an assignment is a model of a formula if it satisfies the formula. It's a countermodel otherwise. A formula is satisfiable if it has a model, and it's unsatisfiable if it has no model. Okay, so all of this is, I hope, very standard so far. Good. So let's start combining things. Okay, so I can say, let P be the set of, assume we have two variables, P and Q. Okay, P is the set of assignments that makes the variable P true. Q is the set of assignments that makes the variable Q true, and so on. You can combine them. Okay. Now I will define a function on this lattice. I will call it a model transformer. What it will do is you give me a set of assignments, and if I apply the transformer, I will just remove all the countermodels. Okay. So for example, I start with this formula here, right? Not P or not Q, and P or Q. And I apply the model transformer for that formula to the set Q, right? So the set Q contains an assignment that makes P true and Q true. And if P and Q are both true, I cannot satisfy the first clause above, okay? So that assignment is a countermodel, whereas if P is false and Q is true, that assignment is a model. So this transformer maps the element Q to this element here. Are you with me so far? Okay, question. I take the model transformer and I apply it to the top element of the lattice. What do I get? So maybe not specific to this lattice. In general, what would I get? Because the definition above is not specific to this lattice.
The largest
thing. Yeah, so you will get all the models of the formula, right? It's kind of, so if I applied it here, I would actually get this. And this formula actually encodes XOR, and this is just the set of assignments where P and Q have different values. Okay? Any ideas for what the highlighted elements are? Yeah, okay. So if I apply the function to any of the highlighted elements, I will remain there, okay? So it doesn't change because these sets contain only models of the formula. So these are, in other words, the fixed points of the transformer, okay? And one thing to notice is that if I apply the transformer to any element, I will always go down because given a set, I'm only going to remove elements from it. And once I've gone down, I only have models, right? So if I apply the same function again, I will stay at the same point. Okay, I can do the same with the counter models. Maybe I will skip this. But so all this does is it throws away the models and keeps the counter models. Okay, so same as before. So that allows us to think in terms of the models of a formula in terms of something on a lattice. We can think of it in terms of programs, right? I have a program here with some variables that are initialized to arbitrary Boolean values. Okay, so under what conditions is the assertion violated? Come on, are you with me? So the assertion is can be violated if and only if the formula is satisfiable, right? Otherwise, there's no satisfying assignment. Okay, so again, you can now start thinking in terms. Now, this seems a bit crazy, but we will come back to it. So this is not surprising at all because programs are much more complicated objects than formulae. So encoding a formula into the behavior of a program is not surprising. It's purely a pedagogical device, I guess, to help think about it. But it will become relevant later. Okay, so we're ready to make our first formal statement, which is, I said that a formula is unsatisfiable if the model transformer applied to the set of all assignments gives me basically the models, right? So if this set is empty, the formula is unsatisfiable. I can do the same with the counter model transformer, and this is easy. So the connection to programs becomes relevant because this model transformer is equal to the post transformer for the statement assume phi, right? Because if you start with a set of assignments, the assignments are like the environments, right? They map variables to values to runtime values, right? So post is just telling you if you execute this statement and you start with some set of environments here, what will you get afterwards, right? For this specific statement, the only environments that can go from here to here are those models of the formula. Okay, so this is relevant because this transformer is now implemented in existing abstract domains, right? And maybe not in the propositional case that we will see that exists in SAT solvers, but for various other domains, this is available. We can start using it, okay? And I will use this to formalize satisfiability algorithms. Okay, so I stopped with Gödel, but the formalization of logic was a big step was made by Tarski, who defined the model's relation, and he used relations and sets, okay? Oh, sorry. Yes, this should be a 9. Uh, Yes. Sorry about that. So, but the paper that's relevant for the next part of the talk is his famous paper on fixed points, which is possibly his most used result in computer science. And why is that relevant? Well, so I told you that the model transformer, if you apply it to the set of all assignments, will give you the models, right? So if we apply the model transformer twice, we take the set of all assignments, we only have the models, right? If I apply it again, I should get the same set. So I started from the greatest element of my lattice. I applied the function once, I got a new element. I apply the function again, the element doesn't change. So the set of all assignments is the greatest fixed point of this model transformer. So why would I want to do something so terrible, right? I can see the pain in some of your faces. I took something as nice and beautiful and simple as Boolean satisfiability, right? Just an assignment and a formula, and I turn it into some big, ugly, complicated object like the greatest fixed point of a transformer on a lattice. Well, so the reward is going to come shortly. And you can also do the same with the set of countermodels. Okay, so we have the satisfiability problem. We have a fixed point characterization of satisfiability. Can we use this fixed point characterization to reason about satisfiability? Let's do some deduction. And we can do it by reasoning about a formula, right? So the earliest person I know who tried to build a SAT solver was William Stanley Jevons, who in 1869 built this object called the logic piano, which if you are ever in Oxford, I invite you to go to the Museum for the History of Science. It's about this big. And it could reason about four variables, okay? And yeah, so if that's funny, I heard Moshe Vari talk about this once, and he said, yeah, you think that's funny? You try building a theorem prover out of wood, right? And yeah, it's not that easy, right? And he actually wanted to scale to 16 variables, but his office was not big enough to contain the new device, okay? So I will jump almost 100 years to the work of Martin Davis and Hilary Putnam. They were interested in two things. They were interested in working on Hilbert's 10th problem, but they were also heavily interested in automated deduction. And they had funding, I forget the name of the organization now. So they wrote in 1958 this report, which was then published in 1960 on trying to program methods for Boolean satisfiability. And this paper contains a lot of ideas that still have found their way to modern SAT solvers, like the one literal rule, the resolution rule, and the pure literal rule, and a few others. Okay, so let's look at their method in more detail. Okay, they formalized their method in terms of formula, in terms of syntax. And then when they tried to implement it, it wasn't as efficient as they would have liked. So in 1962, or in a paper published in 1962, Martin Davis had two students, Donald Loveland and George Loachman, implemented in a different way using a recursive structure and not over the syntax of the formula but using semantics. Okay? And this changed the efficiency quite a lot. So I will look at actually formalizing the first part of the procedure that appears in this paper. Okay? So now, you know, I said that there were two traditions of logic, the algebraic one and the relational one, and now I've moved to programs. And so there is automated deduction happening on one side. Tarski in Berkeley had an undergrad student who was working in the library, and you know, as all undergrads do, he was rifling through some papers on model theory and got really excited, worked with Tarski, learned a lot about fixed points, later wrote this famous paper called The Lattice of Flow Diagrams, which connected work in computer science to fixed points and lattices. And this work, you know, finds its way in modern static analysis today. So it was also influenced the work of Gary Kildall, who was working on program optimization. And in his work, he formalized constant propagation, which was implemented in compilers, over lattices. So what does this have to do with whatever I was talking about in the work of Martin Davis and Hilary Putnam earlier? That comes in the slides. So this is the lattice that was used by Gary Kildall for constant propagation, or equivalently, that was used by Martin Davis and Hilary Putnam for the one literal rule, if you want. So what did they do? They said, we will track whether a variable is true or false, but we will not track multiple assignments at the same time. Okay? So this allows you to say there are no satisfying assignments. At the top, you have all satisfying assignments. This element here represents one satisfying assignment where x is true and y is true. Here you have x is true and y is false. On top, you know that x is true and you know nothing about y. Okay? So that element there is a partial assignment, right? Only some of the variables are assigned. You can think of it as representing a set of assignments, right? So it represents a set of all assignments in which x is true, which is kind of what happens in constant propagation as well, right? You know the values of some variables, and other variables become unknown. In the Boolean case, not in the general case, this is also equivalent to what is called the Cartesian abstraction. Right? You have to do some reduction. I will not go into those technical matters now. Okay, so the basic data structure that was being used in the DLL procedure was partial assignments. What is the propagation routine that they use? So one of the core sources of efficiency in modern solvers is a routine called Boolean constraint propagation. And again, there are lots of things that make modern solvers fast. I'm only talking about the algorithmic aspects. This alone is not enough to build a very efficient solver. So, you know, I'm not playing down any of the other things. But so you do need the efficient implementation of the algorithms. You need the heuristics and all of that. But this is a starting point. Okay, so let's do Boolean constraint propagation. Initially, we know nothing about the formula. Okay, so one way to reason very efficiently is only conclude things that are obvious. What is obvious about this formula for it to be true? What must be true about this formula? X must be true, right? So we can write that down. We can, in fact, write it down using a partial assignment or just an element of the constant propagation abstraction. So we know that X is true. Given that X is true, what must be true about the formula? Right? So given that X is true, if you take the next clause, X will not be satisfied. So you know that Y must be false. Ooh, sorry. That's a mistake. Sorry, I've made a mistake there. So that should be Y should be false. Okay. So given that Y is false, what must be true about the formula? I hope you can ignore what's on the slide. Z? Why? Why should Z be true? Okay. So you do have that, but you're deducing something about W now, right? But if you just look at the assignment at present for all the other clauses, there are at least two unknowns. If you think of the first two steps we did as elimination of unknowns, in the first two clauses, at each point there was only one unknown, and we just concluded if there's only one unknown, we can make a conclusion about its value. If there are two unknowns, then the procedure will actually give up. Okay? So the rule that I was using is called the unit rule. It says that if all literals but one in a clause are false are false due to a partial assignment, the remaining literal must be true. Okay? So it's a sound but incomplete proof rule because there could be multiple unknown literals and then you don't know. And the idea of Boolean constraint propagation is to repeatedly apply the unit rule. Okay? So now let's formalize that using abstraction. Oh, I'm not sure why the sorry about the background. Abstract interpretation, right? So although you use the same lattice as constant propagation, we are not doing constant propagation when we do Boolean constraint propagation. Okay? And there are simple programs like the one I showed you where you have if phi assert false that a modern SAT solver will be able to prove correct for you. But constant propagation will not be able to prove correct. Okay? So even though they use the same abstraction, they're reasoning in different ways. Okay? So now let's formalize the reasoning that's actually happening. It's not what happens in standard constant propagation. So assume that I have now a transformer that's defined on the lattice of partial assignments. Okay? And the partial assignments lattice, I can lift the model transformer so that I over-approximate the actual set of models of the formula. Okay? I'm going to define it over partial assignment. So for example, if I apply it to bottom, which represents no assignments, well, then it contains no assignments, so I will stay here. If I apply it to X is true and Y is false with this clause up there, okay, this assignment satisfies that clause. Because it satisfies the literal not y. So I will stay here because this is a model of the formula. Okay? So the same argument applies here. If I apply it to this element, x is false and y is unknown, well, the part x is false satisfies the clause, so you don't change this element any further. You stay there. Okay. If, however, you apply to this element, assume that y is true, and you don't know anything about x, right? So if y is true and you know nothing about x, and you want to satisfy this clause, then you know that x must be false, then the transformer will map this element to this element here. Okay? So now we're building an abstract transformer. This abstract transformer actually models the unit rule. Okay? And I'm just making it explicit over partial assignments. The point is, we can actually prove something about that. So the partial assignments correspond to constant propagation, correspond to the Boolean Cartesian abstraction. There is a well-known Galois connection between partial assignments and sets of assignments. And if you take the unit rule, and if you take the transformer that I informally defined on the previous slide, but it's really just the unit rule, okay? So in their 1979 paper, I think, Couzeau and Couzeau defined the notion of a best abstract transformer, which is the maximal precision you can get in an abstract domain when you abstract a transformer. And that can be characterized by such a function where you start in the abstract, you go down to the concrete, you apply your concrete transformation, and then you come back to the abstract. Okay? So what you can show is that the unit rule is the best abstract transformer for a clause on the lattice of partial assignments. Okay? And have I lost everybody, or is it too trivial? Should I go faster? I don't know. I can't tell anything from the deadpan reception of the audience. Okay, so I will just keep going. Tell me if you're suffering at some point. Okay, but that only models a clause. It doesn't model a formula. So here's a thought experiment, right? I give you an unsatisfiable formula. What is the best abstract transformer for an unsatisfiable formula? Let's go back to the previous slide. Best abstract transformer. So we take the set of all assignments, and let's apply it to the top element, right? Let's apply it to top. So take the set of all assignments, you go to the concrete. So you have all assignments in the concrete. You apply the model transformer. The formula is unsatisfiable, therefore I get the empty set. I apply the abstraction function, I will get bottom, right? So the best abstract transformer for a formula which is unsatisfiable will map every element to bottom, okay? So calculating this transformer is as hard as solving the set problem, okay? And that's not what you do, right? This is where the abstraction enters the picture. So you use the best abstract transformer for each clause, but their conjunction you don't do in the concrete, you do in the abstract, okay? So you take the meat, the pointwise meat of all the abstract transformers, okay? This gives you deduction. It just says, take the unit rule for each clause and apply it, okay? This is all it's saying, right? You have a partial assignment, apply the unit rule for each clause. And Boolean constraint propagation repeatedly applies the unit rule until information doesn't change. So, and you start knowing nothing, and you repeatedly apply the unit rule, and you get more and more information. If you think of the lattice, you're starting at the top and working your way down. In other words, Boolean constraint propagation is the greatest fixed point computation using a deduction transformer. You can prove this. Okay? So I'm not going into proof details here. I'm just giving you sort of the view of the landscape. Any questions at this point? Okay, I will keep going. Yes. And, so I should mention one thing. So it is in the finite lattice. In this case, it's only for the lattice of partial assignments, okay? But this computation, so is it correct to say, you know, that, all these static analysis people discovered the same thing as Davis and Putnam, but just 10 years later, 20 years later? Well, not quite, because the lattice of constants is not only for Boolean values, right? It's for arbitrary constant values. And then this idea of iterating a greatest fixed point, well, it appears in, I believe, your thesis. And there is a paper on constructive versions of Tarski's fixed point theorem, which led to Philippe Granger's work much later for a technique called locally decreasing iterations. So if you want the one-line abstract interpretation summary, then the generalization of this idea would be bottom-up abstract interpretation with locally decreasing iterations, right? But it would be for other lattices. And in general, termination might be a problem, and then you need to do other things. The point is, yeah, with the formalization, you can lose the dependency on the finite Boolean assumptions that are in the background. Okay. So this is not just entirely in the abstract. This has some consequence, which is if you know static analysis or you know abstract interpretation, you can go and open the code of a SAT solver, at least some of the clean SAT solvers. I'm not an expert. I guess you can ask Leo more questions about this when he comes. But you can read some parts of it as if it were the code of an abstract interpreter. So here's some code taken from Minisat. If you look at up there, you have true, false, and undefined. That's the true, false, undefined values. And then you have a vector that maps variables to true, false, undefined. So that's literally the elements of the abstract domain. You have a propagate routine, which is going to compute your fixed points for you. And the one additional thing you need is the OK part, which checks if you've actually reached bottom. Okay, so this is kind of the abstract deduction. So let me skip this for now. We will come back to it later. So I mean, you know, so people have said, so are you just saying that this is just abstract interpretation? And you know, that's not surprising because abstract interpretation is such a general theory. Well, the point is, just because abstract interpretation is a general theory doesn't mean that the formalization of something in abstract interpretation is trivial or obvious, or that this formalization doesn't give you anything new, right? And the formalization gives you things going in both directions. One is for us, as people coming from program analysis, we have access to SAT technology. So if I read the code of Minisat, I look at things that are implemented, and I read this as ways to efficiently implement certain abstract domain operations, because they've implemented this lattice of abstract, this partial assignments abstract domain, and you know, so the way it's implemented to use bit vector operations to be as close to the architecture level as possible, to have as low overhead as possible, this is kind of, yeah, cool idea. So that's something to begin there too. Okay, so that was, we have deduction. You start from a point and you want to derive conclusions about that. You can do that in the concrete, and we saw that using the lattice-based view, you can go and do it in the abstract, okay? So that's what Boolean constraint propagation is doing. What about abduction? Does that have any rule? Okay, so let me give you, I will skip this one. I will do this one. Yeah. The universal, it's a big name. We have the same formula as before, and we have the same lattice as before. But what the transformer that I'm introducing now is going to do is you give me a set of assignments. I will throw in all the counter models of the formula. If there are models, I will leave them. Okay? So suppose, so this formula represents the XOR of P and Q, right? So suppose I apply it to the empty set, then there are no models in there. What I will do is throw in all the counter models, right? Which are the elements where P if and only if P and Q have the same value, okay? If I apply it to top, well, I have all the elements, so I will stay there. And if I apply it to P, then I will go to union. Is this kind of, it's just you give me a set of assignments, I add all the counter models, okay? So, question, can I formulate satisfiability in terms of this transformer? Yes, so I mean that's one way. So I was thinking of a simpler one, which is that because I add all the counter models, if I apply it to the empty set and I get top, that means every assignment is a counter model. That means the formula is unsatisfiable, okay? And now there's some nice duality going on, which is, I think, not, yeah. So actually what you said is right, sorry. What you said is right, because, yeah, you, actually, yeah, I wasn't thinking. So that, yeah, there is the property that the model transformer that I defined before, if you put not F not, then you get this one. Yeah, and then exactly what you said would apply. But I think that's a stronger property because it would, it would follow from that, but they're not equivalent, I think, the flipping, because there could be multiple fixed points and so on. Yeah, okay, so now we can play the same game and we say instead of the greatest fixed point, I start from below the empty set, I add in all the counter models if I'm at top. So this is, you know, I start from below, I work my way up in the lattice, so I have a least fixed point, okay? So a formula is unsatisfiable if and only if the least fixed point of this countermodal transformer contains all assignments. So once again, we can say, let's apply abstraction to this, right? So before we said we start from top, we go, and then we check if I have bottom. And what we did was we said, OK, this might be expensive to compute. So I can do this using abstract interpretation. And what you do is you over-approximate the set of all models. If the over-approximation is also empty, then the formula is unsatisfiable. That's what we did before, right? So now we would have to start from the empty set. We would go up to the set of all counter models. If the under-approximation of the set of all counter models is all assignments, then the formula is unsatisfiable. Okay, so there is a problem here. Before I go here. So there is a problem here. Name an under-approximating obstruction. Right? This is not entirely easy. Okay, so there is a slight problem here. In the other case, we had over-approximating obstruction. There are lots of them. There are lots of implementations of them available. Under-approximating obstructions, not so easy. Okay? Yes, but so that's the point, right? I didn't say impossible, right? So I would like to introduce one idea, which is one way to think about this. So essentially, you need some kind of disjunction. If you think of, I have some element, and I want to under-approximate it, I go to some abstract domain, and then I take all the elements below this in the abstract domain, and I take their join, right? And if I can stay below, then I have an under-approximation. This is the basic idea. So we can think about this using the idea of downward closed sets. Okay, so I have this lattice here. There are many properties this lattice does not have. For example, I have a partial assignment where x is true. I have a partial assignment where y is true. Suppose I want to say x is true or y is true, right? I cannot express that in this lattice. I will just go directly to top because the join over approximates the actual union. Okay, so one way to get around that is to use something called the disjunctive completion of an abstract domain. One way to do disjunctive completion is to use the notion of downward closed sets. So what is a downward closed set? Suppose I have an element in the lattice, just take everything below it, okay? So this is the downward closure of that, it's everything below that. So suppose I have two elements, I need to take everything below both of them. So suppose I have the element here, x is true, y is false, x is false, y is true. And the downward closure is allowing me to just express something like x is false or y is false, okay? And you can represent the downward closure by the maximal elements which will form an anti-chain, but, okay? So why is this relevant? Let's go back to the operation of a set solver, okay? And I will just try to intuitively define for you an abstract transformer that works on the downward closure. Okay, so let's take the downward closure of sets of partial assignments. We already have an implementation of, so, I mean, you can think of the abstract model transformer here as the unit rule, but you don't have to, okay? So what we are going to do, let me do it on the formula. So I have this formula here. This formula is unsatisfiable, right? It's just saying x if and only if y and x, x or ry. Just a formula and its negation. If you applied Boolean constraint propagation to this, it would give you no results because there is no unit clause here. So let's apply abduction to it. I start with bottom, so I know nothing. Okay. I can ask, give me those assignments, give me those partial assignments, such that if I applied the unit rule with a partial assignment, I would get bottom. So I'm going to go backwards. Right? So, for example, if I have x is true and y is false, then x is true and y is false will not satisfy the first clause. I cannot satisfy the formula. If x is false and y is true, I will not satisfy the second clause. I will not satisfy the formula. And so on. Okay. So this is the first step. I can go to the next step and say, well, I don't need these. I can have, I'm going to work my way up in the lattice, right? So anything that implies these elements, right, would also give me a way to conclude something is unsatisfiable. So again, I'm hand-waving here, but suppose we could say, well, x is true, y is false, x is false, y is true. We know things like resolution. We will say, well, so it's enough for x to be true, right? So I can throw this in. So in this way, we can start from below and throw in assignments and keep going up. And then we get top, okay? And basically, we have gone to the top element, and then we can say, okay, the formula is unsatisfiable. This is a terrible idea, okay? And the problem is the first step, right? Which requires to implement some sort of enumeration. But I was just trying to illustrate the idea that you could start from below and use partial assignments and work your way up, okay? So what you really want is some nicer under-approximation of this, okay? So what happens in solvers, I'm just going to very briefly summarize for you. Suppose I have a formula like the one above, and suppose I reason about it in this way, meaning what this graph, this is called an implication graph, or I mean this is a fragment of it that would be called a conflict graph, I guess. Correct me if I'm wrong. So I assume U, and I assume not V. And then from these I conclude from the first clause, for example, that W must be true. And then I keep going, okay? So what I'm writing down here in the graph is from U and not V and the first clause, we concluded that W must be true, okay? Given that W must be true, from the second clause, we know that X must be false. So I can write that down. Given that W must be true, from the third clause, we know that Y must be true. So I can write that down, okay? So these are implications. Basically, I'm logging what is happening in the BCP step. So what we know is that if you start with these assumptions and you're applying the unit rule, you will eventually deduce that the formula is unsatisfiable, okay? Now, if you make a cut in this graph, right, the cut represents a condition under which the formula is unsatisfiable. So we know that if I start with these two elements, not X and Z, I can deduce that the formula is unsatisfiable, right? If I start here, but if you think of, you start from here, which is bottom, and you work your way back, right? I'm able to say, well, here, so think about this, right? Think about this in terms of the abstract domain element. I know that X is false, I know that Z is true. I know nothing about the other variables. So this is actually a partial assignment, okay? So from the graph, I am able to conclude a partial assignment, which gives me a condition under which the formula is unsatisfiable. I can take another cut in the graph, which gives me another condition, right? So before we said, okay, can we find sets of partial assignments from which we can conclude that the formula is unsatisfiable? And this union will give you an under-approximation of the set of countermodals, right? So in fact, every cut in the graph, take all cuts in this graph, they represent a set of elements or a set of partial assignments, so a set of abstract domain elements that under-approximate the set of countermodals. Formula, right? And it's under approximate because we've made some assumptions here and you're only going to pick certain cuts in the graph. Okay, so fine. So a set of cuts in a conflict graph under approximate the universal countermodal transformer. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I wanted to elaborate this idea of you can over approximate deduction, you can under approximate the abduction step. Both of these in isolation may not be complete reasoning procedures. Okay? So even if I am modeling what happens in a real solver, I'm obviously missing something because actual solvers, at least in the propositional case, are complete. Right? So one question would be, what are the solvers doing? And what makes them complete? Right? And the idea is refinement, but refinement broadly construed. Okay, refinement of an analysis. There are many ways in which you could refine an analysis. So I'm really going to give you only a schematic description now. I'm not going to give you the precise mathematics anymore, I hope. So we have the idea that we have over-approximate deduction, we have under-approximate abduction. They can both be incomplete. If we want completeness, what should we do, right? And I'm not saying what should we do, I'm going to tell you what do solvers do, and I'm just going to explain it using the program analogy. So the classic DPLL method would say I do Boolean constraint propagation. It might give me incomplete results. So what can I do? I can make assumptions. I can say P is true or I can say P is false, right? For some unknown P. And this allows me, imagine I have started at the top element, I go down in the lattice, I stop somewhere, right? I take this element, I replace it with the assumption that P is true, I replace it with the assumption that P is false. And then I continue computing from there. So I refine one fixed point into a set of fixed points, right? So implicitly, you're adding the disjunction slowly, basically. You're doing branching. Okay, this idea has also existed in static analysis. So I think Holly and Rosen did qualified data flow analysis way back in the 80s, but sort of the modern way I view this, or I have been able to understand or view these techniques, is a technique called trace partitioning. Are you the author? No, okay, I wasn't sure. I don't know what they look like. I have mixed you up with somebody else. Okay, so this is the classic DPLL technique. When I gave this talk in September, an earlier version of this in Microsoft, Byron Cook had asked me, well, what about Stallmark's method? And I went back to Leo and I said, what about Stallmark's method? And he said, oh yeah, you know, it's obvious. Just. And then later we discovered that Aditya Thakur and Tom Reps in, I think, Wisconsin Madison have been studying this for a while, and they have two papers now. So I will not talk much about this. You can read about an abstract interpretation, formalization of Stallmark's method and its application to various problems in their work. But basically, if you do the splitting in classic DPLL, you will get this tree, right? And that can get expensive. So what Stallmark's method is doing is you can say, assume P, assume not P, and then when you do deduction under these two assumptions, you take the join afterwards. So you only keep the facts that you can derive on both branches, okay, and then you continue. Because now you might have more information, you can run the original again, okay? So you can think of Stallmark's method as, and this is actually known, okay, so this is not new, I think. This part is really known. I'm not sure why it wasn't exactly spelled out in this way before, but you can basically find this in the SAT literature, I think people have said. Okay, so the main thing is, what about conflict-driven clause learning? So I will comment a bit more on that. So if you just think of clause learning is a bit different because, I forgot to mention one thing. I said there's abduction, and I forgot to add the comment that just as you have the post, which is like the strongest post condition, if you have the abduction, what is happening there in terms of standard predicate transformers? Does anybody have any idea? Yeah, I know, but you gave it away. I was just wondering if anybody actually was even reading this line. Okay, it's like the weakest precondition, okay, and it was under approximating weakest preconditions. But okay, so the idea is you have a program like this. Yes, please.
So you have a guesswork prediction. Mm-hmm.
Yes. In the concrete, right?
So concrete,
yes. This is true.
Thing,
exactly. Yes. So what I find surprising is that people are using both in the abstract also, right? Yeah. That's, I think, not so common, right? So you have a program, and I can replace it. Instead of this program, I learn a clause, right? I do some deduction, I learn a clause. And I can add that clause here, in the beginning. And now analyzing this program with this learned clause allows me to conclude more, right? And again, I will make assumptions and then I will learn another clause every time, okay? So I can think of it as dynamic discovery of trace partitions, but it's a bit more sophisticated because you're not manipulating elements of the abstract domain, you're really learning a transformer, right? If you think about this, you're changing the constraints to the program, really, right? So it's like the formula became a transformer, I had a deduction transformer, right? And when I learn a clause, I'm adding something more. So I have the transformer, and I'm trying to compute a fixed point. And in the clause learning, I'm actually adding something to this transformer to change the fixed point I will actually compute. Okay. So this is really, you know, very high level. I thought I'm going to be here for a few days. Maybe I've lost a lot of you, but this is for those who want to discuss the idea a bit more. So I presented it at a slightly high level, but there's a bit more going on. So in DPLL, classic DPLL, you have a formula, you make an assumption P, you make an assumption not P, and then you go and deduce. This is sound, right? In conflict-driven clause learning, it's a bit more complicated because you make one assumption, you say assume P, that's what you will do. You will first try to compute a greatest fixed point using the unit rule. And when you're done, if there are still some unknowns, you will assume something. You say assume P or assume Q, right? And then you keep computing with this. So if you think about it, you start at the top element, you compute a greatest fixed point, you're not happy with the precision that you have. You arbitrarily step down. Unlike classic DPLL, where you replace it by two and continue computing because their union is still covering the concrete fixed point, you have now stepped down. You made one decision, not two. Then you keep going from there. Okay? So where have we seen this before? In static analysis. that we, so when you compute least fixed points here, I need to set the room on fire or something, I don't know. Yeah. Well, they could, yeah, okay. So normally you would compute a least fixed point and then you want convergence acceleration, you try to jump up in the lattice, okay? So this is literally turning the picture upside down. You're computing a greatest fixed point and then you jump down in the lattice. There are a few differences though, because you first reach the fixed point and then you jump down. This is kind of cool. This is, I don't know, I haven't seen this before, I think. Because you are, so it's the dual of the usual widening, dual widening, but you're doing it for precision. You do it in this finite lattice, but you jump down to increase precision. Okay, so then we had the conflict, we analyze it using the kind of graph I showed you before. You would do abduction, which would give you all the sets, all the cuts. That's a bit too expensive, so you choose some subset of the cuts. And now again, computing the cuts in the graph, this is a least fixed point computation, okay? But you under-approximate a least fixed point, okay? So once again, in abstract interpretation terminology, I'm sorry if I'm losing some people here. Normally, we would have an operation called narrowing, where you've jumped above the fixed point, above the greatest fixed point, or to a post-fixed point, and then you try to iterate below and stay above the fixed point, okay? So you over-approximate a fixed point, so it's an operation to do that. And here, you have the set of all conflict reasons, and you're going to under-approximate it. So you can compute it by least fixed point, but you want to under-approximate a least fixed point. So it's the dual of the usual narrowing operation. Yeah, and so there you have it. I mean, this would be one way to view the clause learning architecture as you do a greatest fixed point on this side, you do a least fixed point on the other side. In both, in one side, you might lose precision, so you try to jump down in the lattice arbitrarily to gain more precision. And the other side, for space reasons, or, you know, you don't, there are lots of concerns that you need to address to not kill the solver. You have to very judiciously choose small, relevant clauses. So you can view it as doing a narrowing. And I mean, these are kind of techniques that we could steal, basically, right, and try to apply to other problems. Okay, so what's the point of all this? Is this pure formalization? Well, not really, because there are a few take-home things. And hopefully Leo will be telling you more about that when he comes here. One of them is you can ask, so what properties does a lattice need to have to support any of these algorithms that I showed you before? So although they have historically been derived maybe from one another and evolved over time, the properties they need to have are different. So if you think of the classic TPLL algorithm, basically given an element, I need to be able to split it up to cover it in the same way, and then I can keep going from there. So if you have finite width bit vectors or something, and if you think of the constant propagation lattice, then I can run DPLL on it. It won't be very efficient, but the idea is I have all elements, I can split it into every element and run it, okay? So the requirements for clause learning are very different. So even though in the propositional case, a lot of conditions collapse and all the algorithms become equivalent on the partial assignments domain, when you go more generally, they're not. So what do you need for clause learning, right? So you start with some partial assignment, and there is a duality here because the negation of a partial assignment is a clause, right? P and Q, you don't know anything about R, S, T, U. You can negate it, you get not P or not Q. This is a clause, right? So what you need are that the elements up here, arbitrary elements in this lattice cannot be complemented. I cannot complement X is true and Y is true. However, I can complement, oh, sorry, I once again messed up. It should be X is true and Y is top. X is, the labeling is completely wrong. Sorry, I'm really sorry about that. I don't know why, because I had this before and it was not incorrect, but okay. So let me explain it. So you have X is true and Y is top, right? The negation of this is X is false and Y is top. So the elements just below the top, their negation exists in the lattice. The negation of arbitrary elements does not. But what's more interesting is that arbitrary elements in the lattice can be decomposed into the meat of elements at the top of the lattice. Okay? Meaning, X is true and Y is false becomes X is true, Y is top, meat, X is top, Y is false. Okay? Other lattices have this property too. So if we go to equality graphs, which are used to reason about equality logic, so first point is equality graphs also form an abstract domain. Because if you think of, I have all the edges, then I have X is equal to Y, X is not equal to Y, and so on. this is bottom because it's not satisfiable. If I have no edges, I know nothing, right? And then you give me one edge, x is equal to y. Y is equal to z, that's below this. X is equal to y is equal to z. And so equality graphs form an abstract domain. Once again, the negation of an arbitrary conjunction of equalities, x is equal to y and y is equal to z, that cannot be represented as an equality graph always. But if I have a single edge, x is equal to y, I can negate that x is not equal to y. So the elements up here at the top, they are closed under complements. They live in the domain. And arbitrary elements in the domain can be derived as the meat of the elements up there. So they are called the meat of reducibles. So this lattice supports clause learning, right? Without having like a Boolean solver in the picture, you can just directly run clause learning on this lattice. Intervals support clause learning because x less than equal to 5, x greater than equal to x less than equal to 5, yeah, x greater than equal to 6, right? The complement exists. But x less than equal to 5 and x greater than equal to 0, the complement of this element, x is in the interval 0, 5. This is not an interval. But it can be written as the meet of two elements whose complements exist. Okay? So, this is like a general condition under which you can lift these algorithms to new domains, basically. And hopefully we can talk about this offline. So, I think it's time to conclude. Let me wrap up. So, we're already slightly over time. So where is this sort of going? Well, there are lots of things I didn't talk about. I apologize if it was too fast or too high level or too heavy for some of you. One thing I only talked about certain iteration. There is a difference between a Galois connection and a Galois insertion, okay? And to communicate this difference, if you think of equality graphs, I have x is equal to y and y is equal to z, right? This represents the set of elements, if you want, where x, y, and z have the same value. So if I think of that equality graph, x, y, z, this equality graph and this equality graph represent the same things by transitivity of equality. But the move from the first to the second, that's, that's closure of equalities. But in the abstract interpretation setting, you would model it as the reduction operation that you apply to a lattice to get a Galois insertion. And in fact, basically, largely a lot of theory reasoning can be captured as doing this step. Right, a lot of the theory reasoning in SMT solvers is made up of two different things. One is this step, and the second is checking, is an element equal to bottom? Which in the equality case would be given a graph, does it contain a cycle containing a simple cycle with a disequality, right? So at this level, the core can be viewed in terms of this. I think this is relevant in practice because it gives you like clean architectures in which to think about these things, right? Just as we think of static analysis in terms of transformers, fixed points, and independent of what the details of the domain implementation are. So the other thing is, I try to hint at how the clause learning algorithm generalizes because you need this property of meat irreducibles being negated. But this is the essence of being able to construct an implication graph. Okay? So you can build implication graphs over newer abstract domains. You can build implication graphs over the equalities where you have edges labeled with equalities. It's not so interesting there, maybe. But you can do it for octagons or intervals and then try to derive under-approximating abduction transformers in these domains. Right? So this condition is satisfied by all those domains, so a lot of this will generalize there. And, I mean, Kuzu and Kuzu already did some work, and Maubon, on characterizing the Nelson-Oppen procedure using reduced product construction. But I actually think this makes certain things simpler because you don't need to treat the logic as a black box, right? Because if you look inside the solver, it's not using the whole Boolean structure. It's, in fact, already operating on an abstract domain inside, right? So it becomes, I think, it's actually, you solve the harder problem, I would say. The actual algorithmics are somewhat simpler. So, okay, let me zoom to the higher level. Okay, so where are we? My talk today largely focused on, so here's a picture of, you know, logic as one could view it. So you can have just Boolean reasoning. You can throw in fixed points, you get something like the view calculus. You can throw in first order reasoning, because you want to do arithmetic. And if you have first order operations as well as fixed points, basically you have programs, right? So all of this is living at a concrete level, right? When you want to reason about this, in practice, even the simplest problem here is computationally intractable. So we always use abstraction, right? And what I have learned is that there's a very precise sense in which the abstractions inside very efficient solvers is characterized by abstract interpretation. So we want to move to the abstract and hopefully be able to take very efficient technology that exists in different parts and, you know, make our way to the other end of the cube. So there is one more point before I conclude, which is, so really we have programs which we can think of as sets of traces, and we have environments and all of that. Usually we reason about them by already moving to sets of states and predecessor, successor transformers. And now you can further throw away a structure to say, okay, what is the smallest logic in which I can reason, right? So if you just throw away the behavior, then you will just get Boolean logic. You have no state transitions, right? I could also throw away negation and get something like just. So one thing that we can see from the SAT solvers is, even though we want to reason in this logic here, there is a procedure to do Boolean reasoning in a non-distributive, non-Boolean lattice, right? Because the lattice of partial assignments is not Boolean, it's not distributive. So we are able to do Boolean reasoning by sitting in a non-Boolean domain. So, you know, in a complete way, at least in the finite case. So the question is, for the other things, what is the gap, right? What is the richest logic we can reason about by using the coarsest, practically usable abstraction, right? So not, and yeah, so hopefully we will discover that in some years too. I mean, lots of people are working on this, okay? So this is just saying my view of it, but the people I have been working with, Daniel, my supervisor, Leo, a lot of this work will be reported in his thesis. He will be here next week. Michael, there are a few other people whose pictures I don't have. There's Aditya Thakur and Tom Reps, who are in Wisconsin-Madison. They're combining abstract interpretation and Stallmark's method. And and there's lots more people working at this intersection. So apologies if I missed your name. Don't be mad at me. Okay, thanks.